All the elephants in the lines jumped up as if they'd been shot, and their grunts at last waked the sleeping mahouts, and they came out and drove in the picket pegs with big mallets and tightened this rope and knotted that till all was quiet. One new elephant had nearly grubbed up his picket, and Big Toomai took off Kalanag's leg chain and shackled that elephant forefoot to hindfoot, but slipped a loop of grass string round Kalanag's leg and told him to remember that he was tied fast. He knew that he and his father and his grandfather had done the very same thing hundreds of times before. Kalanag did not answer to the order by gurgling, as he usually did. He stood still, looking out across the moonlight, his head a little raised and his ears spread like fans, up to the great folds of the Garo Hills. "Tend to him if he grows restless in the night," said Big Toomai to Little Toomai, and he went into the hut and slept. Little Toomai was just going to sleep too, when he heard the coir string snap, with a little tang, and Kalanag rolled out of his pickets as slowly and as silently as a cloud rolls out of the mouth of a valley. Little Toomai pattered after him, barefooted, down the road in the moonlight, calling under his breath, "Kalanag! Kalanag! Take me with you, oh Kalanag!" The elephant turned, without a sound, took three strides back to the boy in the moonlight, put down his trunk, swung him up to his neck, and almost before Little Toomai had settled his knees, slipped into the forest. There was one blast of furious trumpeting from the lines, and then the silence shut down on everything, and Kalanag began to move. Sometimes a tuft of high grass washed along his sides as a wave washes along the sides of a ship, and sometimes a cluster of wild pepper vines would scrape along his back, or a bamboo would creak where his shoulder touched it. But between those times he moved absolutely without any sound, drifting through the thick Garo forest as though it had been smoke. He was going uphill, but though Little Toomai watched the stars in the rifts of the trees, he could not tell in what direction. Then Kalanag reached the crest of the ascent and stopped for a minute, and Little Toomai could see the tops of the trees lying all speckled and furry under the moonlight for miles and miles, and the blue-white mist over the river in the hollow. Toomai leaned forward and looked, and he felt that the forest was awake below him, awake and alive and crowded. A big brown fruit-eating bat brushed past his ear, a porcupine's quills rattled in the thicket, and in the darkness between the tree stems he heard a hog bear digging hard in the moist warm earth and snuffling as it digged. Then the branches closed over his head again, and Kalanag began to go down into the valley, not quietly this time, but as a runaway gun goes down a steep bank, in one rush. The huge limbs moved as steadily as pistons, 8 feet to each stride, and the wrinkled skin of the elbow points rustled. The undergrowth on either side of him ripped with a noise like torn canvas, and the saplings that he heaved away right and left with his shoulders sprang back again and banged him on the flank, and great trails of creepers all matted together hung from his tusks as he threw his head from side to side and ploughed out his pathway. Then Little Toomai laid himself down close to the great neck lest a swinging bough should sweep him to the ground, and he wished that he were back in the lines again. The grass began to get squashy, and Kalanag's feet sucked and squelched as he put them down, and the night mist at the bottom of the valley chilled Little Toomai. There was a splash and a trample, and the rush of running water, and Kalanag strode through the bed of a river, feeling his way at each step. Above the noise of the water, as it swirled round the elephant's legs, Little Toomai could hear more splashing and some trumpeting, both upstream and down, great grunts and angry snortings, and all the mist about him seemed to be full of rolling, wavy shadows. "Aye," he said, half aloud, his teeth shattering. "The elephant folk are out tonight. It is the dance, then." Kalanag swashed out of the water, blew his trunk clear, and began another climb. But this time he was not alone, and he had not to make his path. That was made already, 6 feet wide in front of him, where the bent jungle grass was trying to recover itself and stand up. Many elephants must have gone that way only a few minutes before. Little Toomai looked back, and behind him a great wild tusker with his little pig's eyes glowing like hot coals was just lifting himself out of the misty river. Then the trees closed up again, and they went on and up, with trumpetings and crashings and the sound of breaking branches on every side of them. At last Kala Nag stood still between two tree trunks at the very top of the hill. They were part of a circle of trees that grew round an irregular space of some 3 or 4 acres. And in all that space, as little Toomai could see, the ground had been trampled down as hard as a brick floor. Some trees grew in the centre of the clearing, but their bark was rubbed away and the white wood beneath showed all shiny and polished in the patches of moonlight. There were creepers hanging from the upper branches, and the bells of the flowers of the creepers, great waxy white things like convolvuses, hung down fast asleep. But within the limits of the clearing there was not a single blade of green, nothing but the trampled earth. The moonlight showed it all iron grey, except where some elephants stood upon it, and their shadows were inky black. Little Toomai looked, holding his breath, with his eyes starting out of his head, and as he looked, more and more and more elephants swung out into the open from between the tree trunks. Little Toomai could only count up to 10, and he counted again and again on his fingers till he lost count of the 10s, and his head began to swim. Outside the clearing, he could hear them crashing in the undergrowth as they worked their way up the hillside, but as soon as they were within the circle of the tree trunks, they moved like ghosts. There were white-tusked wild males with fallen leaves and nuts and twigs lying in the wrinkles of their necks and the folds of their ears. Flat, slow-footed she-elephants with restless little pinky-black calves only 3 or 4 feet high running under their stomachs. Young elephants with their tusks just beginning to show and very proud of them. Lanky, scraggy old maid elephants with their hollow, anxious faces and trunks like rough bark. Savage old bull elephants scarred from shoulder to flank with great weals and cuts of bygone fights and the caked dirt of their solitary mud baths dropping from their shoulders. And there was one with a broken tusk and the marks of the full stroke, the terrible drawing scrape of a tiger's claws on his side. They were standing head to head, or walking to and fro across the ground in couples, or rocking and swaying all by themselves, scores and scores of elephants. Toomai knew that so long as he lay still on Kala Nag's neck, nothing would happen to him, for even in the rush and scramble of a kedah drive, a wild elephant does not reach up with his trunk and drag a man off the neck of a tame elephant. And these elephants were not thinking of men that night. Once they started and put their ears forward when they heard the chinking of a leg iron in the forest, but it was Padmini, Peterson Sahib's pet elephant. Her chain snapped short off, grunting, snuffling up the hillside. She must have broken her pickets and come straight from Peterson Sahib's camp. And little Toomai saw another elephant, one that he did not know, with deep rope galls on his back and breast. He too must have run away from some camp in the hills about. At last there was no sound of any more elephants moving in the forest, and Kala Nag rolled out from his station between the trees and went into the middle of the crowd, clucking and gurgling, and all the elephants began to talk in their own tongue and to move about. Still lying down, little Toomai looked down upon scores and scores of broad backs and wagging ears and tossing trunks and little rolling eyes. He heard the click of tusks as they crossed other tusks by accident, and the dry rustle of trunks twined together, and the chafing of enormous sides and shoulders in the crowd, and the incessant flick and hish of the great tails. Then a cloud came over the moon, and he sat in black darkness. But the quiet, steady hustling and pushing and gurgling went on just the same. He knew that there were elephants all around Kala Nag, and that there was no chance of backing him out of the assembly, so he set his teeth and shivered. In a kedah, at least there was torchlight and shouting, but here he was all alone in the dark, and once a trunk came up and touched him on the knee. Then an elephant trumpeted, and they all took it up for 5 or 10 terrible seconds. The dew from the trees above splattered down like rain on the unseen backs, and a dull booming noise began. Not very loud at first, and little Toomai could not tell what it was. But it grew and grew, and Kala Nag lifted up one forefoot and then the other and brought them down on the ground, one, two, as steadily as trip hammers. The elephants were stamping all together now, and it sounded like a war drum beaten at the mouth of a cave. The dew fell from the trees till there was no more left to fall, and the booming went on, and the ground rocked and shivered, and little Toomai put his hands up to his ears to shut out the sound. But it was all one gigantic jar that ran through him, this stamp of hundreds of heavy feet on the raw earth. Once or twice he could feel Kala Nag and all the others surge forward a few strides, and the thumping would change to the crushing sound of juicy green things being bruised. But in a minute or two the boom of feet on hard earth began again. A tree was creaking and groaning somewhere near him. He put out his arm and felt the bark, but Kala Nag moved forward, still tramping, and he could not tell where he was in the clearing. There was no sound from the elephants except once when two or three little calves squeaked together. Then he heard a thump and a shuffle, and the booming went on. It must have lasted fully 2 hours, and little Toomai ached in every nerve, but he knew by the smell of the night air that the dawn was coming. The morning broke in one sheet of pale yellow behind the green hills, and the booming stopped with the first ray, as though the light had been in order. Before little Toomai had got the ringing out of his head, before he'd even shifted his position, there was not an elephant in sight except Kala Nag, Pudmini, and the elephant with the rope galls, and there was neither sign nor rustle nor whisper down the hillsides to show where the others had gone. Little Toomai stared again and again. The clearing, as he remembered it, had grown in the night. More trees stood in the middle of it, but the undergrowth and the jungle grass at the sides had been rolled back. Little Toomai stared once more. Now he understood the trampling. The elephants had stamped out more room, had stamped the thick grass and juicy cane to trash, the trash into slivers, the slivers into tiny fibres, and the fibres into hard earth. "Wah!" said little Toomai, and his eyes were very heavy. "Kala Nag, my lord, let us keep by Pudmini, and go to Peterson Sahib's camp, or I shall drop from thy neck." The third elephant watched the two go away, snorted, wheeled around, and took his own path. He may have belonged to some little native king's establishment, 50 or 60 or 100 miles away. 2 hours later, as Peterson Sahib was eating early breakfast, his elephants, who had been double-chained that night, began to trumpet, and Pudmini, mired to the shoulders with Kala Nag, very footsore, shambled into the camp. Little Toomai's face was grey and pinched, and his hair was full of leaves and drenched with dew, but he tried to salute Peterson Sahib and cried faintly, "The dance! The elephant dance! I have seen it! And I die!" As Kala Nag sat down, he slid off his neck in a dead faint. But, since native children have no nerves worth speaking of, in 2 hours he was lying very contentedly in Peterson Sahib's hammock, with Peterson Sahib's shooting coat under his head, and a glass of warm milk, a little brandy, with a dash of quinine inside of him. And while the old hairy, scarred hunters of the jungle sat 3 deep before him, looking at him as though he were a spirit, he told his tale in short words, as a child will, and wound up with, "Now, if I lie in one word, send men to see, and they will find that the elephant folk have trampled down more room in their dance room, and they will find 10 and 10 and many times 10 tracks leading to that dance room. They made more room with their feet. I have seen it. Kala Nag took me and I saw. Also, Kala Nag is very leg-weary." Little Toomai lay back and slept all through the long afternoon and into the twilight, and while he slept, Peterson Sahib and Machua Appa followed the track of the two elephants for 15 miles across the hills. Peterson Sahib had spent 18 years in catching elephants, and he had only once before found such a dance place. Machua Appa had no need to look twice at the clearing to see what had been done there, or to scratch with his toe in the packed, rammed earth. "The child speaks truth," said he. "All this was done last night, and I have counted 70 tracks crossing the river. See, Sahib, where Pudmini's leg iron cut the bark of that tree. Yes, she was there too." They looked at one another, and up and down, and they wondered, for the ways of elephants are beyond the wit of any man, black or white, to fathom. 40 years and 5, said mature Appa, "have I followed my lord the elephant, but never have I heard that any child of man had seen what this child has seen. By all the gods of the hills it is, what can we say?" And he shook his head. When they got back to camp, it was time for the evening meal. Peterson Sahib ate alone in his tent, but he gave orders that the camp should have 2 sheep and some fowls, as well as a double ration of flour and rice and salt, for he knew that there would be a feast. Big Toomai had come up hopfoot from the camp in the plains to search for his son and his elephant, and now that he had found them, he looked at them as though he were afraid of them both. And there was a feast by the blazing campfires in front of the lines of picketed elephants, and little Toomai was the hero of it all. And the big brown elephant catchers, the trackers and drivers and ropers, and the men who know all the secrets of breaking the wildest elephants, passed him from one to the other. And they marked his forehead with blood from the breast of a newly killed jungle cock to show that he was a forester, initiated, and free of all the jungles. And at last, when the flames died down, and the red light of the logs made the elephants look as though they'd been dipped in blood too, mature Appa, the head of all the drivers of all the kedars, mature Appa, Peterson Sahib's other self, who had never seen a made road in 40 years, mature Appa, who was so great that he had no other name than mature Appa, leapt to his feet, with little Toomai held high in the air above his head, and shouted, "Listen, my brothers, listen too, you, my lords in the lines there, for I, Machuapa, am speaking. This little one shall no more be called Little Toomai, but Toomai of the Elephants, as his great-grandfather was called before him. What never man has seen, he has seen through the long night, and the favour of the elephant folk and of the gods of the jungles is with him. He shall become a great tracker. He shall become greater than I, even I, Machua Appa. He shall follow the new trail and the stale trail and the mixed trail with a clear eye. He shall take no harm in the kedar when he runs under their bellies to rope the wild tuskers. And if he slips before the feet of the charging bull elephant, the bull elephant shall know who he is and shall not crush him. Ahai, my lords in the chains!" He whirled up the line of pickets. "Here is the little one that has seen your dances in your hidden places, the sight that never man saw. Give him honour, my lords. Salaam Karo, my children. Make your salute to Toomai of the Elephants. Gunga Pashad, aha! Hira Guj, Birchi Guj, Kuda Guj, aha, Pudmini. Thou hast seen him at the dance, and thou too, Kalanag, my pearl among elephants. Aha, together, to Toomai of the Elephants, Barayo." And at that last wild yell, the whole line flung up their trunks till the tips touched their foreheads, and broke out into the full salute, the crashing trumpet peal that only the Viceroy of India hears, the salamat of the Kedah. But it was all for the sake of little Toomai, who had seen what never man had seen before, the dance of the elephants at night and alone in the heart of the Garo Hills.